Everybody, this is Dr. Vishal Trivedi from Department of Biosciences and Bioengineering, IIT Guwahati. And what we were discussing about the biology course of class 11 and 12 under the IIT PAL program. And in this series, we were discussing about the chapter Biotechnology Principle and Processes. And if you recall what we have discussed in our previous lecture. So in the previous lecture, we discussed about the definition of the biotechnology and how the biotechnology is helping the scientist as well as the helping the scientists to develop the different types of products and how the biotechnology is contributing in terms of the developing the new products or to the solve the some problems. So in this in that particular lecture, we discussed about the some of the biotechnology products like the bread or the curd and how the previously discovered knowledges as well as the information about the metabolism could be helpful for the scientists to utilize these information to develop the curd or the bread. And in that particular series, we also discuss about the how the biotechnology is utilizing the two different principles. Either it is utilizing the genetic engineering as a tool to generate the genetically modified organism, or it is utilizing the bioengineering or bioprocess technology to enhance the product production. From the organism. So while we were discussing about the genetic engineering, we discussed about the that the genetic engineering relies on the tools as well as the techniques. And within the tool, we discussed that the biotechnology depends on to the some of these major tools like polymerases, restriction enzymes, as well as the ligases and the vector, whereas in the case of procedures, if you want to generate the genetically modified organisms, what you are supposed to do is first you have to isolate the genome of the particular organisms, and then from the genome you have to use. So first procedure what you have to learn is the isolation of the genomic DNA, and then with the help of the polymerase enzyme you can be able to isolate the gene, and that you have to achieve simply by going with the polymerase chain reactions. And once you got the gene, you have to cut this gene with the help of the restriction enzymes. So the restriction enzyme, you have to perform a restriction digestion reactions, and then once you done the restriction digestions, it is actually going to generate the sticky end on the both side of your gene. With the same way, you have to also isolate the plasmids. The plasmids are the vectors which are actually going to carry the gene of your interest. Then you have to restriction digest the plasmids so that it is also going to generate the sticky ends. And now you have to take the cut gene as well as the cut plasmid and put them together within the ligation reactions. So you have to learn also about the ligation reactions, and then you have to transform or you have to put this particular DNA into the host cells. So in this case, I have taken an example of the bacteria, but you can be able to use the different types of host cells, like you can use the yeast head cells, or you can use the mammalian cells, or you can use some other cells for generating the genetically modified organisms. So you have to use the different types of DNA delivery systems. So in this case, since we are taking the bacteria as a host, you might have to first prepare the competent cells, and then you have to do the transformations. Once you got the transformed cells, then you are going to also perform the screening. But for example, in this case, you see that you have some of the blue color screen, blue color cells, and some are red color cells. So once you put them under the screening, you are going to see that the clone, the cells which actually contains your DNA, is only going to grow. And so this way you can be able to understand the complete procedure of the genetic engineering, so that you can be able to utilize this to generate the genetically modified organisms. So in this particular series, let's first start the discussing about the tools, so that you will be able to be familiar with the tool part, and then we will discuss about the procedures, so that once we will discuss the procedures, you will be able to understand the utility of these tools. So in this series, we will start with the polymerases. So as the name suggests, the polymerases means the enzyme which is actually going to catalyze the reactions of the polymerizations. So in this case, the polymerase are actually polymerizing the nucleotides, and the enzyme, the polymerase, synthesizes the double-stranded DNA molecules with the same size and the sequence, which means if you use the polymerases, it is actually being used to synthesize the genomic DNA or the DNA in general. So what you can imagine is that you have the parent DNA, and if you put the DNA polymerase, it is actually going to make the another copy of this particular parent DNA, and that's how it is actually going to generate the DNA for the second generation, the third generation, the fourth generation, and the fifth generation. So what is more important, so, and that's why it is important that the polymerases should actually be able to synthesize the DNA, which should be in the identical size as well as the sequence, because if there will be any change in the size or the sequence, it is actually going to generate the mutations, and these mutations could be, or there could be a degradation of the DNA. So the mutation or the DNA degradation, because it doesn't, if this particular parent DNA is of the 1 KB and the synthesized DNA is going to be 890, then base pairs, then it is actually going to reduce the size of the DNA, and that actually is going to lose some information. So and apart from that, the sequence is also very important, because if it is synthesizing the some sequences and the sequence is not identical to the parent DNA, it is also going to contribute in terms of the acquiring the different types of mutations, and these mutations could be life-threatening, or it could also affect the physiology of the particular cell. When the polymerase is working in a living cell, so before we discuss about the role of polymerases in the genetic engineering, let's discuss about the role of polymerases in the normal life cycle of a particular organism. So I have taken two examples. I have taken an example of the bacteria, and I have also taken an example of the mammalian cells. So let's discuss first about the bacteria. So in the bacteria, you know that it has the plasma membrane, or it has a cell wall, and then it has the plasma membrane, and within the plasma membrane, you have the genomic DNA or the chromosome. So before in the first step, what happened is this genomic DNA or the chromosome is actually going to be duplicated. So ultimately what you are going to do, and the bacteria will also grow. So in this process, the bacterial cell is going to be double the size, and as well as it is actually going to have the two chromosomes. One is in this side and the other one is in this side, which means here you have the one set of chromosome, whereas here you are going to have the 1+1, but still these two chromosomes are present in a single cell. So afterwards, what will happen is it is actually going to go through with the cell division, and that's how the bacteria is going to divide and give and form the two different cells. So at this stage, when the bacteria will start dividing, it will first going to duplicate the chromosome or the genomic DNA of the DNA content of So at this stage, the DNA polymerase is actually going to be very active, and that's how the DNA polymerase is actually going to synthesize the chromosomal DNA into the two DNA, and once the two DNA are formed, then actually the cell is going to get the signal that since the DNA synthesis is over, we can actually go with the division stage, and that's how it is actually going to divide and form the two cells. Now, in the case of eukaryotic cell, the cell go through with the different phases of the cell cycle. I'm sure you might have discussed and or studied these cell cycle stages in your previous chapters. So cell go through with the G1 phase, where it actually prepares the cell for the growth, and it also prepares for the S phase. And within the S phase, the DNA is going to be duplicated. So one set of DNA is actually going to form, and it is actually going to synthesize the another set, and that's how it is actually going to have the two copy of the genomic DNA. And then it will enter into the G2 phase, and within the G2 phase, it is actually going to prepare the cell for the cell division, and then it will enter into the M phase, and in the M phase, it is actually going to divide and form the two cells. So the mother cell will again continue with the cell cycle, whereas the daughter cell is going to form the new cell, which means it is actually going to form the new cell. And the genomic DNA, what is present in the daughter cells, the two daughter cells, is going to be identical. So what we have understood from these two examples is that if you actually going to remove the DNA polymerase from this whole exercise, so in this S phase, the DNA polymerase is very active, whereas in the case of bacterial cell, when the duplication of chromosome will start, that stage the DNA polymerase is very active. So does not allow the DNA polymerase to work properly, or it is actually going to destroy the halt the cell division as well as the growth of the particular organism. And that is important. That is only because the DNA polymerase contributes into the duplication of the genomic DNA or the DNA content. Utilizing and understanding this particular potential, the people have started exploring the enzyme which is responsible for the synthesis of the DNA. And that's how the Robert Kornberg actually discovered the first DNA polymerase, which is responsible for the synthesis of the DNA. And that's how it is actually been possible to utilize that enzyme for the genetic engineering. So DNA replications, if you are does not know or you would like to recall, the DNA replication is a process of duplication of the entire genome prior to the cell division. It has a biological significance because it is actually going to be extremely accurate. In eukaryotes, the replication occurs only during the S phase, during the S phase of the cell cycle, and the replication rate in eukaryote is slower, resulting in a higher fidelity or the accuracy of replication in eukaryotes. DNA replication has the three events. One is called as the initiation. So in the initiation, the DNA is going to prepare for the synthesis. In the initiation phase, the proteins are going to bind to the DNA, and then the DNA is going to open to form the single stranded DNA. So you know, the DNA is a double helical structure. So this double helical structure has to be converted into the double stranded structure so that the enzyme could be able to read the bases, what is present within this particular DNA. And then after this, this DNA is going to be converted into the single stranded DNA so that the nucleotide could be accessible for the enzyme to reach, and that's how it is actually going to synthesize the complementary strands. Once this happens, that the DNA is going to be prepared for the single stranded DNA, then the enzyme will, then the process will enter into the elongation phase, where the protein will connect the correct sequence of the nucleotide into the continuous new strands of the synthesis, which means at this stage the DNA polymerase is going to work and it is actually going to synthesize the next strands with the nucleotides, and this process is going to continue until the enzyme reaches to the end of the strands. And once it reaches to the end of the strands, the DNA polymerase is going to be released from the replication complex, and the process is going to be terminate, and it is actually going to stop the synthesis of the DNA synthesis. So, realizing this fact that the DNA polymerase is actually being used in the cell for DNA replication, which involves these three events. But if you see the number of proteins, what is being responsible for this process is very huge. For example, the helicases, the primases, and the SSPs. These are the three proteins which are being responsible for the first step, that is the initiation step. And the DNA polymerase is responsible for the T3 proteins are responsible for the elongation as well as the termination phase. So this is responsible for elongations, and once it reaches to the end of the DNA, then it enters into the termination. So you can imagine that the DNA replications actually involves these three or a huge set of proteins. So that's why the scientists have discovered the different way of entering the DNA into the initiation stage, so that you don't have to rely on these proteins, because you can imagine that the helicases, which is actually going to separate the two strands, then the primases, which is responsible for the primer synthesis, and then the SSB protein, which actually going to prevent the re-annealing of single standard DNA, is required to be functional in a very, very coordinated fashion. For example, when the helicase will come, it is actually going to separate the two strands, then only the SSB will come, because if the SSB comes before and the helicases comes later, then they will not be able to work properly. And because of that, the scientists have decided not to use any of these enzymes for the DNA replications, even for the genetic engineering purpose. What they have used, they have only used this enzyme for the genetic engineering. And how the DNA polymerase can be utilized for genetic engineering? So now you can imagine that the genome is full of genes. So you can have a genome of an organism where you have the different types of genes. You have the gene 1, gene 2, gene 3, gene 4, gene 5, and gene 6. So I have shown you all the genes with the different colors. So now imagine that I want to, you know, clone this particular gene and overexpress this gene along with the into the bacterial expression system, so that I can be able to produce the protein corresponding to this particular gene. So what I will do is I will put the DNA polymerase under a reaction called as the polymerase chain reaction. So polymerase chain reaction does not utilize any of the proteins what we have discussed previously, like the helicases or SSB or all other kinds of T3 proteins. Instead, it utilizes the physical properties like the temperature itself to catalyze the different steps of the initiation, the elongations, and all that with the help of the DNA polymerase, because DNA polymerase is the only enzyme which actually is doing the nucleotide additions or the elongation steps. So once you do that, you are actually going to get the gene. Now this gene has to be processed further with the help of the next set of enzymes, so that it should actually going to generate the sticky ends. And once it generates the sticky ends, it can be incorporated into the vector. So once you have synthesized the gene of your interest, like for example, in this case, I have taken an example of gene 1, you have to go through with the downstream process and utilize the next set of tools for the generating the sticky ends. So what is the next set of tools? The next set of tool is called as the restriction enzymes. So what are restriction enzymes? Tristitian methylase system is very close to like the immune system present in the mammalian cells. So it actually have a ability to distinguish between the self versus the foreign DNA. Although the precise mechanism of distinction is not known, but based on the available literature, in the absence of methylation, a closed complex is formed and it allows the proper activation of cleavage activity of enzyme. But presence of methyl group, even the hemimethylation on nucleotide, does not allow the formation of closed complex, and consequently enzyme falls from the DNA. So the Tristitian methylation system or the RMS system is actually recognizing the DNA, whether the DNA is belonging to the host cell, which means, for example, if you are talking about the bacteria, whether the DNA is belonging to bacteria or whether the DNA is belonging to the foreign organisms. Like, for example, if you are talking about the bacteriophage, so the immune cell, the bacteria will have the immune system like the Tristitian methylase system, which actually will recognize the DNA, whether it will be self DNA or the foreign DNA. Because if many of the infectious organisms, when they attack to the host cell, for example, in the case of E. coli, and we are talking about the bacteriophage, it is actually first going to inject the DNA. And once the DNA will enter, it will integrate along with the chromosomal DNA. So before the DNA will reach to the chromosomal DNA, the DNA is going to be recognized or the going to be tested by the Tristitian methylase system. So whether the DNA is belonging to the bacteria itself or whether the DNA is belonging to the bacteriophage. If it is belonging to the bacteriophage, then it is actually going to be damaged or it is going to be cleaved by the Tristitian enzymes. If it is belonging to the self, then the methylase system is actually going to protect the self DNA from the action of the Tristitian enzymes. So you can imagine that how the Tristitian methylase system works is that you can imagine that it has the different types of Tristitian sites. For example, RE1, RE2, RE3, RE4, and these are the different set of DNA sequences. So what will happen is that the Tristitian methylase system is actually going to scan this particular part of DNA with the help of the different enzymes, whether the Tristitian enzymes or the methylase systems, and then they will bind to these different sequences in a random fashion. So they will bind to these sequences. If these sequences are methylated, they will not be able to form the closed complex. If they will be non-methylated or if they are non-methylated, for example, in this case, the RE2, the sequence of this DNA, the red color DNA, is non-methylated. So as soon as it happens, the DNA will, the enzyme will bind to this and it will form the closed complex. What is mean by the closed complex is that the Tristitian enzyme is now going to access the DNA, because if it is not going to form the closed complex, the Tristitian enzyme will not be able to form the closed complex. And once it forms the closed complex, then it is actually going to cleave this particular part of DNA and it is actually going to generate the two or more fragments. And once this happens, the enzyme is going to be released, which means once the closed complex is formed, you see that the Tristitian enzyme has actually bind the DNA. And now DNA is bending because it is binding to through the major group. And that's how the DNA is going to now cleaved at multiple places. And that's how it is actually going to release. So in the mechanism part, the enzyme is going to first recognize the cleavage site, or it is actually going to scan the DNA. So Tristitian enzymes have the specific recognition sequence to rapidly identify the site. Enzyme scans the stretch of DNA through a non-specific interaction and diffusion along the length of DNA. To expedite the recognition process, the enzyme does not make interaction with the bases. Instead of it makes the contact with DNA backbone. Now, once this happens, then it binds to the recognition site. Once the recognition site is located, which means in this case, it is the red color DNA sequence, enzyme makes the specific interaction with the nucleotide present at the recognition site by entry to the major group. Hydrogen bonding, van der Waal interaction plays crucial role in this step. Enzyme DNA closed complex forms the major conformational changes in the recessional enzyme, and that's how the recessional enzyme are actually going to reach to the very close to the DNA, and then it is actually going to perform the cleavage reactions. The closed complex activate the cleavage activity of the enzyme, resulting into the introduction of DNA breaks on both strands to give you the fragment with 3' overhang, 3' OH overhang, or the 5' phosphate overhang. So once this happens, the enzyme is going to cleave the DNA. But you can imagine that if there will be methylation or hemimethylation, which means if there will be a methylation, so what nucleotide is getting methylated? Only the adenine is getting methylated. So if it is methylated on both the strand, then it is called as the methylated. If it is a methylation on only one of the strands, then it is called as the hemimethylated strand. Irrespective of whether it is a methylated strand or the hemimethylated strand, the DNA is going to be protected from the recessional enzyme cleavage. Because the people have discovered the different types of recessional enzymes, there was a need to give the name to the recessional enzymes. Because recession enzymes are having the very, very huge application in terms of the genetic engineering and to generate the particular type of recombinant DNA, people have discovered different types of recession enzymes from the huge amount of different types of microorganisms. So because of that, there will be a need for having a nomenclature so that once you say that, okay, I'm talking about the EcoR1 or BAMH1, you should be able to understand the what enzyme I'm talking about. So due to the extensive search of the presence of recessional enzyme in different organisms, a nomenclature system has been adopted. In this system, you have the four letters. For example, in this case, you have this is a recessional enzyme, the name is EcoR1. The first alphabets represent the name of the genus or the organism, the genus of that particular organism from where the particular enzyme is being isolated. The second alphabet represents the species. The third alphabet gives the information about the strain. And the fourth is in the order in which the enzyme has been isolated from the particular microorganism. Order means whether this is the first enzyme or the second enzyme or third enzyme, because it is possible that that particular organism might have the multiple restriction enzymes, and it could possible that you might have discovered the first restriction enzyme, then the second and third and fourth and all that. So because of that, if you only have the three alphabets, then it will be very difficult to say whether you're talking about the first enzyme or second enzyme or the third enzyme. So for example, we are talking about the EcoR1. So in this case, you have E. So E is Escherichia, which is actually the genus of that particular bacterium. Then you have the CO. The CO is corresponding to the coli, which is actually the species of that particular bacterial strain. And then you have the R. So R is corresponding to the strain. So R is called as the strain, which is called as RY13 strain. So this is a specific strain. And then because this is the first enzyme, so that's why you are putting the 1. So it is the first recessional enzyme discovered from that particular bacteria. Similarly, for example, you can have another enzyme which is called as BAMH1. So BAMH1 is another recessional enzyme. And what I will suggest you is that you should give me the information about in terms of the this information, like what is the genus of this particular bacteria, what is the species of this particular bacteria, what is the strain and all that. And you could be able to do this and try to see that how useful this particular kind of system is, that it actually gives you the complete information about this particular enzyme. So apart from the nomenclature, the rectification enzymes are different types of, there are different types of rectification enzymes what is present in the system. So we have the type 1 rectification enzymes, then we have the type 3 rectification enzymes, and then we have the type 2 rectification enzyme. The type 1 rectification enzymes actually are recognizing a DNA sequence which is 3 to 4 nucleotide at 3 prime end, followed by a non-specific stretch of 6 to 8 nucleotide and a 4 nucleotide at 5 prime, which means the type 1 rectification enzymes are utilizing a DNA sequence, but it is very, very loose or very, very relaxed. The cleavage site is approximately 1000 base pair away from the recognition site, and it is presumed that the cleavage follow a DNA translocation. So you can imagine that the type 1 rectification enzymes are actually working on a DNA, and then what they do is, if they found the rectification sequence, that sequence which is like consists of 3 to 4 nucleotide and all that, they will going to cut after 1000 base pair, which means the cutting is also not going to be very specific. The recognition is also not very specific. It only is going to look for these 3 to 4 nucleotides and so on. So that's why the type 1 rectification enzymes are not useful in terms of the genetic engineering. Similarly, in the type 3 rectification enzymes, the recognition has had two separate non-palindromic sequences arranged inversely oriented. The cutting site is 20 to 30 base pair away from the. So in the case of type 3 also, it is actually going to be better than type 1, but it is actually going to recognize and cleave approximately 20 to 30 base pair away from the rectification site, which means this is also non-predictable whether it is going to cleave on this side or whether it is going to cleave on this side, and that's why it is not useful and it is not going to be precise. So the third is the type 2 rectification enzyme. So type 2 rectification enzyme is 4 to 8 nucleotide long, and it cuts the DNA within the specific site, which means if you have a type 2 enzyme and it recognizes here, it is actually going, and suppose this is the stretch of DNA where it is actually getting the rectification enzymes, so it is actually going to cut within the rectification site, which means you know where precisely the rectification enzyme is going to cut. And due to this feature, the type 2 rectification enzyme have application in genetic engineering for the cloning purpose, because once you know the precise place where the enzyme is cutting, so then only you can be able to use. If it is a non-specific like 20 to 30 base pair or 1000 base pair, then that is not a very good enzyme to use for cloning purposes. Apart from this, so you can imagine that the rectification enzymes EcoR1, for example, so if it is recognizing a DNA, it is actually going to cleave within that particular sequence, considering that this particular DNA is the non-methylated. So in this case, for example, the DNA is non-methylated, it is actually going to generate the sticky ends and it is going to cleave the DNA. If it is a methylated DNA, then it is actually not going to protect, or it is not going to get and form the closed complex, and that's how it is actually going to be get protected. So the rectification, the nucleotide what is actually being modified is actually the adenine. So adenine is being modified by the methylation, and that methylation is actually not allowing the DNA to form the closed complex, and that's how that there will be no DNA degradations. Now, there are different types of properties of type 2 rectification enzymes. First is the palindromic sequence. The recognition sequence of type 2 rectification enzyme is palindromic. What is mean by palindromic is that if you read in the forward direction or whether you read in the reverse direction, it is actually going to be the same. It means that the sequence readout will be same in forward and reverse direction. For example, this is the rectification site what we have given for the BAMH1. So what you have is GGATCC, which means in this forward direction what you are reading? GGATCC. If you read in the reverse direction also, you are going to see GGATCC. And this kind of pattern where the forward direction or the reverse direction reading is going to be identical is called as the palindromic sequence. In the case of, for example, in this MH1 has a repetition site as GGATTC, as shown in the below. The black arrow on strand 1 and 2 will read same sequence, same is applicable to the blue arrow as well. You can take an example as the common example like the Malayalam. So Malayalam is actually, if you read in this direction, it is going to be MALAYALAM. Whereas if you read in this direction, MALAYALAM. So this is actually a kind of a pattern which is called as the palindromic sequences or palindromic pattern, where the forward direction, whether you read in the left side or to the right side, it is actually going to, or forward direction or to the reverse direction, if the reading is same, then you can be able to call that these two, this particular subject or word or this particular sequence is palindromic in nature. Now I can give you the few activities. For example, can you search for few more names and inform me whether those are having the palindromic feature or not. Apart from the palindromic sequence, the type 2 recessation enzymes are also generating the sticky ends. So the type 2 recessation enzyme cuts the both DNA strands together to generate the DNA with hanging over stretch with 4 to 6 nucleotides. These DNA stretch containing fragments are cohesive to each other, as the sequence present on complex 1 will be complementary to the sequence present onto the complex 2. So you can imagine that the this is the replication sites, right, for BAMH1. So if I digest this with BAMH1, and so it is going to recognize this particular sequence, and then it is going to cut within this. So it is going to cut just after the G on both the strands. So this is your, so you can imagine that it is present within the DNA strands. So what will happen? It is actually going to generate a sticky ends, like it is going to generate a arch, right? And this side, you will see, it is actually going to generate a arch which is exactly complementary to this one. So you can imagine that if I put these two sequences back, what will happen is that this one is going to make the interaction with this one. For example, the G is going to make a base pair with G, C, then A is going to make the pair with T, the C is going to make the pair with so on. So with this, so this is like a kind of called as the sticky ends. So what is the advantage of a generating a sticky end? So you can imagine that I have digested the vector as well as the gene of my interest with the BAMH1. So what will happen is the gene of my the vector is actually going to generate this sticky end, whereas the gene is going to develop this particular type of sticky end. So once I put them together, they will eventually going to come closer to each other, and that's how they are actually going to form the complex. So this could be your complex number 1, this could be your complex number 2. So if you put them together, since these two sequences are complementary to each other, they will come together and they will going to form the sticky ends, or they are actually going to form the pair, except that there will be a nick which has to be sealed by the another set of enzyme which we are going to discuss in due course. Now once you set up the recessition enzyme reactions, what you have to very careful is that recession enzyme, what the recession enzyme is doing is it is actually taking a DNA and it is breaking the DNA into the two part, right? It is breaking the DNA into DNA1 and DNA2, right? Which means it is actually a kind of a hydrolysis reaction, which means it is a reaction where the water is very important. So the recessition enzyme requires the water for its reaction, and that's why when you set up the recessition reactions, precision reaction has to be set up in a large volume, which means approximately 50 microliter, so that it should have the sufficient quantity of the water, so that it should have the water to, you know, contribute wherever the cleavage is occurring in terms of the OH or the H plus ions. So this is another station enzyme called EcoR1, and which is called as the GAATTC. You can imagine that if I cut the same vector with the PAMH1 on one side and the EcoR1 on other side, then it is actually going to generate the sticky end on both the sides, which means on this side it's actually going to generate the PAMH1, on this side it is actually going to generate the EcoR1, and in that case your cloning is going to be called as the directional cloning, which means the PAMH1 will fit with PAMH1, the EcoR1 will fit with EcoR1. So it will not going to fit in the reverse orientation, because you can imagine that if I only have the PAMH1, so if I have the B on both sides, for example, like this, B1 and B2, for example, right? This is your vector. And if I have the gene also like B and B, then what will happen? So just to make it distinct, right? I'm just making it the field, right? Now you can imagine that B1 also can match with B1 or B2, right? So it can attach like this, or it could attach with this side. So in that case, the cloning is not going to be directional. Whereas if I have a vector which has BAMH1 on one side and EcoR1 on other side, and so in that case, EcoR1 will go with EcoR1 and BAMH1 will go with BAMH1, which means this end is actually going to stick to this side and this end is actually going to stick to this side, which means if you want to make the cloning directional, you have to use the two restriction enzyme to cut the vector as well as the gene of your interest. And you remember that the restriction enzymes are actually generating the sticky ends for themselves, which means EcoR1 will not going to generate the sticky end which will have any kind of similarity with the BAMH1, and that's why it is possible to have the two enzymes, and that will to have the two enzymes, and that two enzymes are actually going to give you the flexibility of giving the directional cloning. With this, we would like to conclude our lecture here. In the subsequent lecture, we are going to discuss about the different types of procedures. We are going to discuss about the isolation of genomic DNA. We are going to discuss about the PCR, restrictionizations, ligations, competent cell preparation, transformation, as well as the screening of the clone, so that you will be able to see that the recombinant DNA is being generated. So with this, I would like to conclude my lecture here. Thank you.